Today we're going to talk about improper integrals. Improper integrals are integrals that are infinite in some way. So they could be like this picture here, where we're trying to find an integral from 1 to infinity. And so this infinity here is something that we've never seen before. And this would correspond to an infinitely long region that keeps getting skinnier and skinnier as you go off the page this way. You could also have an improper integral if you had a vertical asymptote in the middle of a region you wanted to integrate over. So if you wanted to find that region and there was an asymptote in the middle, that would also be an improper integral because the region you were trying to find would be infinitely long, only this time in the y direction. So how do we define what we mean by an integral from 1 to infinity? Well, we don't have a specific way of finding that yet. But we can find an integral from 1 to any number. So, well, let's see. We usually call that an integral from A to B, so let's call this B. So, for any number B, whether it's here, this is about 10, or here, now we got like 18, or all the way out here, 25. No matter what number B we have, we can find the area from 1 to B. So what we want to do if we want to go from 1 to infinity, we want to just keep making b bigger and bigger and bigger. So what we're going to do is we're going to define the integral from 1 to infinity to be the limit as b goes to infinity of the integral from 1 to b. So let's try this. We rewrite it as the limit as b goes to infinity of the integral from 1 to b of, let's say, x to the negative 2. Dx, and then the antiderivative of x to the negative 2 is x to the negative 1 with a negative out front, and we're evaluating that from 1 to b, and we're taking the limit as b goes to infinity. So now we're taking the limit as b goes to infinity of the quantity. We plug in b, we get negative 1 over b, minus we plug in 1, we get negative 1 over 1, because remember this is negative 1 over x. Alright, so now we're taking the limit as b goes to infinity of just some expression in b. Well, we know how to do that. What is the limit as b goes to infinity of negative 1 over b? Well, that's just going to go to 0, right? It's a form of a number divided by an infinity. So we have 0 minus a negative 1, so plus 1. So this is an answer of 1. So even though this region is infinitely long, it gets skinny so quickly that it has a finite amount of area. So here's our definition. It's just what we said before. For any integral from a number to infinity, we'll write that as the limit as b goes to infinity of the number to b. So there is something new here that's interesting. It says if the limit exists, then the improper integral converges. So this is new vocabulary. An integral converges if this limit actually exists. If this limit doesn't exist, we say it diverges. So that means that maybe there's an infinite amount of area, or maybe the amount of area is oscillating if you're doing something like a sine function. But if you don't get just a single answer, we say it diverges. If f is continuous on negative infinity to b, then the integral from negative infinity to b is the limit as a goes to negative infinity of the integral from a to b. So just like before, only this time we're talking about negative infinity here in the picture instead of infinity on the other side. But what if we have an integral from negative infinity to infinity? This is kind of different. The question becomes, how many limits do you need to have here? Can we write just something like the limit as c goes to infinity of the integral from negative c to c? And the answer is no, we can't write that, because that makes an assumption. That assumes that these two infinities go to infinity at the same rate, which we don't know. We don't know how fast they're getting to infinity. So what we have to do is actually split this integral up. So what we do is we split it at some number c that's in the middle. And then we have two areas, like this green area and this yellow area, that we already know how to find. So let's look at an example. Does the following improper integral converge or diverge? So this is the integral from negative infinity to infinity of sine of x dx. So the first thing is we have to split this into two integrals. So we're going to look at the integral from negative infinity to 0 of sine of x dx plus the integral from 0 to infinity of sine of x dx. Now the number doesn't have to be 0, but it does have to be, you know, some number. It really could be any number between, because any number is between negative infinity and infinity. All right. So now we're going to convert each of these integrals into limits. So we're going to have the limit as a goes to negative infinity from a to 0 of sine of x dx. And this, the number a here is arbitrary. You can call it t or any letter you like. We just usually do a for the bottom one, b for the top one. And then we'll do the limit as b goes to infinity from 0 to b, sine of x dx. So the antiderivative of sine is negative cosine. So we're looking at the limit as a goes to negative infinity of negative cosine of x evaluated from a to 0 plus the limit as b goes to infinity of negative cosine of x from 0 to b. Plugging in gives us the limit as a goes to negative infinity of negative cosine of 0 minus a negative, so plus cosine of a, plus the limit as b goes to infinity of negative cosine of b plus cosine of 0. So now we need to evaluate each of these limits. Remember that cosine of 0 is 1. So we can make this a little prettier before we even take the limits and write limit as a goes to negative infinity of negative 1 plus cosine of a plus the limit as b goes to infinity of negative cosine of b plus 1. Now let's look at each of these limits. As a goes to negative infinity, cosine of a is going to oscillate between negative 1 and 1. So this whole answer is going to oscillate between negative 2 and 0. So we're adding negative 1 to a number between negative 1 and 1. And since it oscillates, then the limit does not exist. We can say the same thing over here. We have negative cosine b. And again, that's oscillating between negative 1 and 1. We're adding 1 to it. So that's going to oscillate between 0 and 2. So that also does not exist. And of course, does not exist plus does not exist gives us a final answer of does not exist. And the way this works is if either of these limits, if you have two limits in the problem, if either one doesn't exist, then your final answer is does not exist. I do want to point out something, though, here. If you had made a mistake and not used different letters here for each of these limits, you might have thought that the cosines would cancel out and give you an answer of 0. And you'd been wrong. So it's really important when you're doing an integral from negative infinity to infinity to take two separate limits. And let's look at what we found based on a graph. So we're finding all of the area under this curve, but we're kind of starting at 0 the way we split it up, and we're moving forward like this, and we're also moving backwards like this. So you can see if they were going exactly together, you know, those two would cancel each other out, and then as this one got filled in and this one got filled in, they would cancel each other out, and this one and this one would cancel each other out. But since they each go off to infinity separately, you have to look at just this one. Okay, well, there's a positive number, now it's back to 0. There's a positive number, now it's back to 0. There's a positive number, now it's back to 0. And so this one oscillates, and then the same thing as you look at this side, it's going to oscillate. So that's why we got an answer does not exist. Now, improper integrals of type 2, these are the ones with a vertical asymptote. So here, what we have to do, if we have a vertical asymptote, like at this point A, we need to write a limit as some other letter goes towards a. Because again, we know how to find this area here between what we called b and c in this picture. We can find this area for each number c. And we can let c get as close to a as we want, but we can't equal a because there's a vertical asymptote there. Same thing if it's on the other side, we're just going to let our number c approach from the other side. So let's look at an example of that. Here we have the integral from 6 to 9 of 1 over the square root of x minus 6. So we're going to have a vertical asymptote here when the bottom is equal to 0. So we say the square root of x minus 6 equals 0 when x minus 6 equals 0, so when x equals 6. So we have an issue here at 6. So we're going to rewrite our integral from a number, we'll say a, to 9, of 1 over the square root of x minus 6 dx. And then we need to take a limit as a gets closer to 6. But since we're looking at this region between 6 and 9, we only care about approaching 6 from the right side. All right, so let's look at this integral from a to 9. Well, let's rewrite this, make it a little bit easier. This is x minus 6 to the negative 1/2. And we're going to do a quick little u sub here. U equals x minus 6. Du equals dx. So we can kind of see that z equals dx. It's not going to be a big change. So we can go ahead and just go straight to the antiderivative. We're going to get x minus 6 to the half divided by half from a to 9. And we're still going to be taking the limit, as this is an a, sorry, as a gets closer to 6 from the right. So now we plug in, we get limit as a goes to 6 from the right of 2, 9 minus 6 to the half minus 2, a minus 6 to the half. Simplifying a little bit, that gives us the limit as a goes to 6 from the right of 2 square root of 3 minus 2 square root of a minus 6. So what happens to square root of a minus 6 as a gets close to 6? Well, as a gets close to 6, we're going to have 6 minus 6, so 0. So this is going to go to 0. So we're going to be looking at 2 square root of 3 minus 2 times 0, which is 2 square root of 3 as our final answer. So note the only thing we really had to do different is because there was a vertical asymptote in here, we had to introduce this limit. We could also talk about integrating over a region that has a vertical asymptote in the middle of the region. If you have a vertical asymptote in the middle of the region, we're going to need two different limits. We're going to have to approach the vertical asymptote from both sides. So again, we're going to have to split this into two integrals and then take two limits. So anytime you need more than one limit, whether it's because you're going to infinity, because you're got a vertical asymptote in the middle, because you've got more than one vertical asymptote, it's good practice to just always split it up so that each integral only has one limit with it. All right, so let's look at this example here. We have the integral from negative 1 to 3 of 1 over x minus 2. And in this integral, we notice that the bottom is equal to 0 when x minus 2 equals 0, so the bottom is equal to 0 when x equals 2. That'll be a vertical asymptote. So we're going to split this integral up at 2. So first we're going to say we're going to look at the integral from negative 1 to 2 of 1 over x minus 2 dx plus the integral from 2 to 3 of 1 over x minus 2 dx. Then we're going to introduce these limits at 2. So we're going to do the integral from negative 1 to b of 1 over x minus 2 dx. And this is going to be the limit as b approaches 2. On which side of the 2 are we going to be on here? Let's think about it. So if we're going from negative 1 up to 3, here's our 2. So we're in this region right here. So we're approaching 2 from the left side. plus the limit as a goes to 2. Now this one must be from the right side of a to 3. 1 over x minus 2 dx. So in our picture, here we've got our a coming in from that side. All right, so now we need to find this antiderivative. The antiderivative of 1 over x minus 2 is natural log of the absolute value of x minus 2. So let's write that down. The limit as b goes to 2 from the left of natural log of the absolute value of x minus 2 evaluated from negative 1 to b plus the limit as a goes to 2 from the right of the natural log of the absolute value of x minus 2 from a to 3. So plugging in gives us the limit as b goes to 2 from the left of the natural log of the absolute value of b minus 2 minus the natural log of the absolute value of negative 1 minus 2. It's a good thing we had those absolute values since we're going to have a negative 3 in there. And then we're going to add to that the limit as a goes to 2 from the right. So we have the natural log of the absolute value of 3 minus 2 minus the natural log. I don't think this is going to fit in here. This is going to be minus the natural log of the absolute value of a minus 2. We'll pretend we squeezed all that on one line. All right, so simplifying a little bit, we have the limit as b goes to 2 from the left of the natural log of the absolute value of b minus 2 minus the natural log of 3. It's negative 3, but it's absolute value, so it becomes positive 3. Plus the limit as a goes to 2 from the right of the natural log of 1 minus natural log of a minus 2. All right, so now we're looking at the natural log of b minus 2 as b approaches 2 from the left. As b approaches 2 from the left, b minus 2 is going to approach 0, and it's actually going to approach 0 from below, but it doesn't matter because we have these absolute value signs. So we're looking at what happens to natural log as you get close to 0, and the answer is that becomes negative infinity. So now we're looking at negative infinity minus natural log of 3, which is negative infinity. So this limit right here is already divergent. It's going to turn out that a similar argument is going to make this limit divergent as well. But just like when we looked at sine, it doesn't matter if you do both limits. Once you found one that's divergent, your answer is going to be divergent. Now, one thing to notice with this integral is that if we hadn't noticed that it was improper and we had just integrated from negative 1 to 3 of 1 over x minus 2 dx, we would have been looking at natural log of the absolute value of x minus 2 from negative 1 to 3, and we would have thought that natural log of 3 minus 2 minus natural log of the absolute value of negative 1 minus 2 was an answer. We would have thought that this actually had an answer, and we would have been wrong. That's bad. So from now on, it's going to be really important whenever you're given an integral for you to check and see if it actually is improper.